Thank you for joining this spotlight on biodiversity conservation. The Bezos Earth Fund's AI for Climate and Nature Grand Challenge is exploring new ideas for multiplying the impact of climate and nature efforts using modern AI. The first round of the Grand Challenge will focus on sustainable proteins, power grid optimization, and biodiversity conservation, as well as other visionary wildcard solutions. This discussion will explore biodiversity conservation and consider opportunities for AI to multiply impact in this field. I'm very fortunate today to be joined by Cristián Samper, who's the Managing Director and Leader for Nature Solutions at the Bezos Earth Fund, overseeing the Earth Fund's work related to the protection and restoration of nature, as well as the transformation of food systems. Prior to joining the Bezos Earth Fund, he served as the President and Chief Executive Officer of the Wildlife Conservation Society for a decade, from 2012 to 2022, overseeing the largest network of urban wildlife parks, hosting 4 million visitors each year, and carried long-term field research and conservation programs in more than 60 countries. And before his time at the Wildlife Conservation Society, he was the director of the Smithsonian National Museum of Natural History. Cristián's joining us today to answer a few questions and share his insights about biodiversity conservation and the Grand Challenge. So welcome, Cristián, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Rebecca. It's a pleasure to be with all of you, and we're very excited to see how we can push the frontiers and test the power of AI to solve some of the nature and climate solutions.
Wonderful. Well, let's get into the focus area of biodiversity conservation. The Bezos Earth Fund is committed to fighting climate change and protecting nature, and the Earth Fund works to achieve that goal across key bodies of work, of which biodiversity conservation is one of them. So can you describe a bit about how biodiversity conservation fits into the broader mission of the Bezos Earth Fund?
Thanks, Rebecca. As you mentioned, the nature strategy of the Bezos Earth Fund has a three-prong element: protect, restore, and transform our food systems. So we feel that we have to protect what we still have left, those relatively intact areas of the planet, which is probably about a third of the planet. We have to restore a lot of the areas that we've lost, especially now in areas in the view of climate change and some of these issues, the topics like connectivity between protected areas have become particularly important. And then we're also looking at transforming the food systems as a way of both reducing the pressure on nature and biodiversity and also mitigating climate emissions. Specifically in the conservation biodiversity area, a lot of our work right now is focused around protected areas and conserved areas, including indigenous territories. So we made a very big, bold, one of the first bets that we made was around what we call 30 by 30, the goal that's now global, to protect 30% of the planet by 2030. We announced that we would invest $1 billion in this initiative, and we're deploying it in particular geographies like the tropical Andes, like the Congo Basin, Brazil, and now the tropical Pacific Ocean, including the Eastern Tropical Pacific and what's called the Blue Continent in Oceania and the Pacific Islands. And what we're doing in these areas is really trying to use science to inform which are the most important areas that need to be conserved. So we're protecting the right 30%, but also trying to figure out ways to improve the effectiveness of the management of these territories. So using remote sensing like satellites to monitor rates of deforestation, but also figure out how we can enhance the monitoring of these places on the ground, how we can identify challenges that may be happening related to mining, to poaching, and many other areas. But in the end, to make sure that these are effectively conserved. So most of what we've done to date is in that area, but we're also interested in looking at some work more related to particular species, some of the critically endangered species that we have in the planet right now, whether it's the disappearing amphibian crisis or some other groups of animals where we feel that our conservation work can be supplemented beyond protected areas to try and help with this. So that's a new area that we're exploring at this time.
Great. And you've started to get into this a little bit. Of course, the Bezos Earth Fund has already done a lot of work in this area, as you've mentioned. Are there any recent initiatives that you'd like to highlight in biodiversity conservation that the Bezos Earth Fund has done?
Well, so the two most recent initiatives that we announced, last year we announced a new effort around Brazil and the Amazon in particular. And we're doing this jointly with many of our other partners and donors in what we call the Protect Our Planet Challenge. And what we're trying to do here is stand behind the government of Brazil right now on their goals to reduce the rate of deforestation in the Amazon, but also secure the tenure and designate 57 million hectares of tropical forest through a combination of protected areas, national parks, but also very importantly, indigenous territories. So we're looking at supporting this effort. And just a few months ago, we announced a new initiative focusing on the Pacific Ocean in what's called the Blue Continent, which is this enormous area that includes 16 Pacific Island states, an incredibly rich area that covers more than 40 million square kilometers. And we're working with the Pacific Island leaders and their forum to do 30 by 30 across this blue continent. That would include the coastal areas, the coral reefs, but also the big areas of open ocean that are critical for fisheries, for tuna, and for the livelihoods and economies of these countries. So clearly there are real challenges there when you have small island states monitoring and enforcing protected areas in these very, very large areas, and how we can use some of the technologies to make this more efficient and more effective.
You talked about some of the enormous challenges that you just referenced. And I'd love to dig a little bit more deeply into that. You know, the impact of the Grand Challenge starts with first understanding and addressing the intractable problems in climate and nature where AI solutions could accelerate progress or might be able to make a contribution. And so in your view, I'd love to hear, what are the greatest barriers holding back transformative impact that you'd like the innovator community to keep in mind?
Well, a goal like 30 by 30 is an enormous goal for the planet. I mean, it's a huge area. We just don't have enough resources to be able to do this. So the question is, how can we monitor more effectively what's going on in some of these areas? Some of this we can do from the air. Some of this we need to do on the ground. And we still don't understand a lot of what's there. We have to remember that we've probably only discovered and described 20% of the biodiversity that's out there right now. So there are many species that we don't know. We don't have accurate data of what's happening to the populations of some of these species. And we need to figure out how we can, our conservation actions are really helping inform this and help protect them, especially some of the species that are endangered through invasive species or other cases, both on land and sea. So I think there's a lot of questions there about identifying the species, around monitoring what's going on, and around measuring the effectiveness and improving the efficiency of the work that we're doing out there.
And can you talk a little bit about how the widespread availability of new technologies has changed the game for biodiversity conservation efforts in recent years?
Sure. So we have a whole range of technologies that are opening this frontier. I mean, clearly remote sensing is one of them. We have new sensors, new tools, new availabilities right now that allow us to monitor so much of the planet from space. Some of the new satellites that are coming up right now are looking at hyperspectral ranges that will allow us to even look at composition of forest, individual forest species or genera of trees. And this, we could do it over very, very large areas and really try and improve this. So that's a critical area that I think is important, but that doesn't tell you everything because we need to know what's going on the ground. We have tools like camera traps and other visual sensors that we can deploy, including drones, but also on the ground camera traps that allow us to monitor what's happening underneath the canopy. And it's critical in terms of especially understanding some of the elusive and critically endangered species. So we have very good estimates now on things like snow leopards. The snow leopard populations are bigger than we thought before. And we're getting this kind of data thanks to these remote sensing technologies that we have right now that allow us, again, to cover a much larger area. And then other tools that I think are particularly interesting right now, so the whole topic of what bioacoustics and how we can listen to nature. We can do it on land, we can do it on sea, and maybe we want to talk a little bit more about it. And the last one I've mentioned is the whole topic of environmental DNA. We're in the century of genomics. The tools that we have right now allow us to sequence DNA, and we can actually track this and identify individual species through DNA barcodes or other tools that we can do. This is, can be incredibly important right now in terms of identifying critically endangered species with very low densities, looking at the presence of some of these things, or in terms of combating illegal wildlife trade. So there are many interesting applications. So we have a whole suite of tools right now that we could use that are generating tremendous amounts of data, but we need to figure out how we can improve the effectiveness and the efficiency of the work that we're doing.
And it's clear how biodiversity conservation impacts the nature as a whole, but I'm curious if you could talk a bit about how it would impact quality of life for humans and sort of where you see those intersection points between biodiversity and humans.
Well, it's totally critical because biodiversity is defined as ecosystems and species and the genetics underpins all life on Earth. We're part of the planet and we depend on everything. Everything we eat, the air we breathe, the water we drink are all ecosystem services. So critically, if we do not sustain that biological diversity, we're not going to be able to underpin the lives that we have. And of course, indigenous peoples and local communities around the world depend on this biodiversity for everything that they do. Not only the crops that they're producing, but the pollinators they're doing, the biological control, so many other species. And even for those of us that live in cities like New York City, where I am right now, we rely on the water that comes from the Catskill Mountains. So there's every single aspect of our lives depends on this biological diversity. And we need to figure out, understand what is there and figure out how we can conserve it and enhance it, especially in view of the impacts of climate change, which is impacting every aspect of our lives, and it's impacting millions of species out there.
I'd love to shift gears a little bit and talk about the Grand Challenge specifically. So the purpose of the Grand Challenge is to address these intractable problems through the use of AI to drive impact in climate and nature, to really explore what might be possible and then create impact on the ground. And so I would love to hear, broadly speaking, what you're hoping to see as a result of the Grand Challenge that's different from current applications of AI in biodiversity conservation efforts.
Well, let me just give you a few examples. As you mentioned, I used to run the Smithsonian National Museum of Natural History, the largest natural history collection in the world. We've been working in identifying the species of this planet for more than 200 years. And yet, at the pace that we're doing it, the way we're doing taxonomy is just very, very slow. We've got hundreds of millions of specimens out there. The question is, how can we accelerate this process? How we can use image recognition, machine learning, so many tools that we have right now to really speed up the process of identifying what we have either in collections or what's out there in the field in a way that's so much faster, because we cannot afford right now to wait and to lose so much of the biological diversity before we get to it. So that's a very clear area that we're examining right now. Another one that we've been very intrigued in some of the workshops that we had recently is the whole field of bioacoustics. It turns out so many of the species out there, birds, amphibians, insects, so many other species are fish, by the way, they're all singing. They're all making noises of different kinds. And you can use this to identify individual species. The power of these kinds of tools is remarkable because we can actually deploy a whole network of sensors out there and listen to nature. We can listen to coral reefs. We can listen to tropical forests and others, and we can generate huge amounts of data. And the question is, how can we use some of the AI tools to sort through that information, identify particular species that are seen there, and how can we use this to analyze the trends? Part of what we want to know is, are there more species, less species? What's the distribution? How are things changing over time? Or how are they responding to the restoration efforts that we're doing? So that's another clear example. And the last one I'll mention is around the area of genomics. Clearly, the whole potential application of environmental DNA and using DNA sequences to identify, not only to identify species, but also to monitor, find presence or absence, seems to be another area that's very interesting right now. We've never had the tools that we thought we had before. We've never been able to generate more information right now, but we need to use tools like AI to be able to sort through it much faster, much more accurately, and much more efficiently.
Absolutely. Maybe just in closing, there are a wealth of resources on the Grand Challenge website that potential applicants can review. Applicants have also seen the selection criteria, which is how they'll be evaluated. But beyond those, I'm curious if there's anything else that you'd like applicants to keep in mind as they develop their proposals.
Well, we're particularly interested in solutions and impact, because we really want to not just use this to understand what's happening, but how do we use that information in a way that will potentially have an impact on the ground? And I think that's a critical issue I would encourage everyone to keep in mind. And of course, to have an impact, we need to figure out solutions that can be scalable. We need to develop technologies and tools that we could use in many places and that can be used by local stakeholders. A lot of the way we like to work is by supporting coalitions of organizations that are willing to work together to address and to solve a problem that's bigger than any one of them. The time is now. We know that there are growing pressures. We're losing a lot of species, a lot of ecosystems. And this is the moment when we need to bring the best minds and the best tools to really be able to have an impact in terms of conserving them, and using them to support the livelihoods of the communities that depend on this biodiversity.
I think that's a great note to end on. So a huge thank you to Cristián today for his time and his expertise. As a reminder to anyone watching, applications are due by 5:59 p.m. Eastern Time on July 30th. Applicants must select a single focus area for their proposals. We're so excited to see what ideas you have for how AI might be able to accelerate progress in biodiversity conservation. I think you've heard some ideas to potentially explore today. And for more on the Grand Challenge, you can visit aiforclimateandnature.org. Thank you.